Okay, here
My
we
name
go.
is Dr. Suzanne Humphreys. I'm a medical doctor. My specialty is internal medicine and nephrology, which is kidney specialty. And over the past 3 to 4 years, I have moved more towards a holistic orientation with an emphasis on the study of vaccination efficacy and safety and necessity.
Dr. Humphreys, when you first began practicing medicine, what were your views on vaccinations and vaccines in general, and how have they evolved or changed, and what are they today?
Today, I'm anti-vaccine. However, 10 years ago, I was not anti-vaccine. I was agnostic about vaccines. I was raised up medically in a system that loved vaccines and that has faith in vaccination. I've written many orders for vaccines. I've received vaccines growing up. I received them before medical school. And frankly, I never thought about them all that much because we're not taught about what's in vaccines in medical school. We're not really taught anything about the downside of vaccines in medical school. We're given the schedule for pediatric vaccinations and told when they're due, and we administer them, which is what I did rotating through my pediatric rotation, really not thinking about it at all, never asking patients when their last vaccine was when they would present with a problem. And given that vaccines are actually drugs that have lots of chemicals and impact on the immune system, we really should be asking that. So it wasn't until later in my career that I began asking those questions after I started noticing certain things happen. And that's when I started doing my research, and I moved from agnostic to someone who questions the necessity of vaccination in this day and age where we are today.
Do you think vaccines are safe?
Well, the reason I say that I don't believe that there's a guarantee for safety with vaccination has to do with where vaccines originate, what is in them, and the lack of studies that we have comparing vaccinated individuals to unvaccinated individuals. And the reason most of us have faith and don't question vaccines is because we've all been vaccinated, because we don't have a look at a group that's been completely unvaccinated. And it wasn't until I actually had experience with a group of people, children, who were totally unvaccinated, that I started to see that what we expect as childhood illnesses and as all the things that happen as we age has something to do with vaccination, because that was the only thing that was different about these children that I met about 4 years ago. I've never seen such healthy children. They did get whooping cough, they did get chicken pox, they had the normal childhood illnesses, but they never required antibiotics. They were never sick for longer than 24 to 48 hours. They were brighter, smarter. It was like talking to aliens after seeing and meeting unvaccinated children. And that's one of the things that got me to really start investigating further, was when I noticed that difference. And I think most doctors and people like you don't have the opportunity to really appreciate the difference between a vaccinated and an unvaccinated person, let alone populations. What we need is a study that actually looks at these vaccinated and unvaccinated populations, and that study hasn't been done. And whenever you want to test any drug to see what the effects are, negative or positive, you need to compare vaccinated and unvaccinated individuals. And if you want to know the long-term effects or downside or upside of the intervention, you have to follow people out for a long period of time. That's never been done with any vaccine. If you think about what's in a vaccine, which most people actually don't think about because they don't know, because it's really not advertised to doctors, it's not advertised to people who are recipients, potential recipients of vaccines. Once you start to look at how a vaccine is made and what's in it, questions have to arise as what could possibly go wrong here that we're not picking up in later years, because some of these issues take weeks, months, or years to develop. Okay, so in order to make a vaccine, you have to first obtain the virus or toxin from the bacteria or a piece of the bacterial cell wall. So you first have to extract disease from an animal or a human. So for instance, with measles, they got blood of somebody who had measles, and they incubated that through a series of cell lines, because you can't just inject live measles into a person. You first have to do what they call attenuating it, which is to make it less virulent. So in order to do that, you pass it through different cell lines. So some of the cell lines that they pass this measles through are human cells, amniotic cells of human beings, chicken cells, monkey kidney cells. Okay, so that's what they do after they get the original virus. They have to pass it through to attenuate it. Then after they do that, they have to multiply it, so that they can make massive amounts of vaccine. In order to multiply it, they'll multiply it on all different kinds of cells, like something called a Maiden-Darby kidney. This isn't for measles, but for flu shots, for instance, Maiden-Darby kidney cells, which are Cocker Spaniel kidney cells that have been made tumorigenic so that they multiply rapidly. Now, part of those cells go into the vaccine. Fibroblasts from fetal lung cells, which came from an abortion in 1966, are some of the other cells that these vaccine cultures are grown on. There's a myriad of monkey kidney cells are still used today, and they've been used for a very long time. So all of these things, all of these animal cells, animal DNA, are part and parcel with a vaccine, and it's even listed on some of the package inserts. So you can imagine that different diseases can be picked up along the way, and that has happened in the past. There have been monkey viruses that were finally, after 30 years, acknowledged to have been causing tumors in human beings, been associated, heavily associated with tumors in human beings. Simian virus 40, if anyone looks that up, it's all over the medical literature. This is not occult science. In addition to that, there are various unknowns that can't be picked up during testing, because if you don't know something is in a vaccine, you can't test for it. You have to have a specific test developed to detect any sort of unknown viruses. And things have been found by third parties. Viruses, stray viruses, have been found by third parties in vaccines. So there is a lot that we don't know that happens with vaccines. So say somebody gets a vaccine and they develop a viral illness afterwards, or tumors afterwards. Can we guarantee that person that the vaccine didn't cause that? No, we can't guarantee it. But most doctors and the medical profession and most lay people will never make any connection between the two things. And there haven't been any studies to really assess the difference in cancer rates between vaccinated and unvaccinated. But we do know that cancer rates have gone up as vaccines have, as the practice of vaccination has grown. We do know that. In addition to any kind of stray viruses that come from animals and animal cells and animal DNA, there are all sorts of chemicals that come along with vaccines. Formaldehyde, which is a known toxin and carcinogen. There still is mercury in vaccines, and there was a lot of mercury in vaccines before they removed it, but there's still trace amounts of mercury in some pediatric vaccines, and there's still mercury in the multi-dose flu shots.
Are there any things in vaccinations that are beneficial or necessary for good health?
Well, I believe that people should maintain the right to have vaccines if they want them. What concerns me most about the practice of vaccination is that people who don't want them are losing their rights to refuse them, and that there are more and more vaccines being recommended to children and to adults all the time. When I was growing up, there were about 6 vaccines in the schedule. Now there are about 32 vaccines in the schedule. When I was growing up, we didn't get our first vaccines until we were around kindergarten age. Now infants are getting their first vaccine when they're hours old. When I was growing up, adults didn't get vaccines routinely and regularly. But now adults are being recommended to get influenza vaccines, whooping cough vaccines, and measles vaccines. So the more vaccines we use, ironically, the more vaccines we need. Because what happens is we lose the natural immunity. For instance, with measles, people would develop long-term immunity for up to 75 years. There are studies that were done in the Faroe Islands that showed that once somebody had measles, they stayed immune for 75 years. It's a long time to stay immune. With a vaccination, the kind of immunity that's provoked is not the same as when you develop a natural disease, and it doesn't last as long. Okay, so if you vaccinate a little girl for measles, she may stay immune to measles for 20 to 30 years. But when she goes to have her first baby, she's not going to be passing her immunity onto that baby the same and as well as she would have had she had the natural disease, because vaccines don't impart the mucosal immunity. So her breast milk won't be as full of protection as it would have been. This is proven in science medical literature as well. I've written about it, and it's in conventional medical literature, that vaccinated women do not impart the same degree of benefit to their infants as women who have had the natural disease. In addition to that, both her child and she will not maintain long-term immunity because we don't have measles around circulating anymore, because part of the herd immunity that was happening, where the term herd immunity was coined, had to do with measles. It had to do with the percentage of people who had measles and were immune to it. And it had to do with the circulation, the ongoing circulation of that virus in the community, which was actually beneficial to adults because they were re-exposed over and over. The same with whooping cough, the same with chicken pox. Okay, look at chicken pox today. Chicken pox, most people know of chicken pox as a pretty benign entity. Now we're vaccinating for chickenpox, and hey, the vaccine's working. We're not seeing as much chickenpox, right? So that seems like a good thing. However, what we're seeing more of now is shingles, because those of us adults who need to be exposed to ongoing chickenpox through children aren't, so we're not getting those natural boosters. And so what happens is our immunity level starts to drop, and the virus can come out our spinal cord and give us shingles, which is basically, it's very painful pustules in a specific area on the skin. This is happening both in children and in adults now. I don't think this is an overall benefit. There are many countries who have refused the very vaccines that we're giving in the United States. So there are other countries who actually agree with me, and their policies are in line with my thinking, that there are too many vaccines too early, and that there's no end in sight to how many vaccines people are going to be recommended to have. Because the more acceptance people have and the more fear they have about disease and the less they know about what they can actually do for these various diseases, which there is a lot we can do and a lot we know about today that actually promotes health, the more of a problem it is. There's no possible way that injecting animal matter, live viruses, and toxins, as well as chemicals, formaldehyde, aluminum, actually promotes health. This is not a holistic practice. Anyone would have to agree to that. There's nothing biochemically or medically necessary about anything that's in a vaccine. It does not fortify us. Vitamin D does, vitamin C does, good nutrition does, good hand washing does, getting sleep and getting adequate nutrition all benefit us and fortify us. And all of those things are what contributed to the decrease in mortality of the supposed vaccine-preventable diseases before these vaccines were ever invented. And what most people are unaware of is that the mortality for diseases like measles and whooping cough was down almost 100% before the vaccines even came on the scene in the developed world. That's pretty startling. Now, imagine if somebody invented a drug that decreased mortality by nearly 100% for any disease. That would be a pretty big deal, wouldn't it? You would hear about it all the time, but yet we don't hear about how hygiene and nutrition is really what prolonged our life expectancy and made us healthier as humanity after the 1800s, when we really hit a big pothole as far as sickness and disease went. I think that's a major big deal that needs more focus. But when these vaccine campaigns are initiated, we never hear about vitamin D and hand washing and even fermented foods that contain isoflavones that can actually have benefited and documented effectiveness in polio prevention. Why aren't we hearing about this in with the hype? All we're hearing about is scaring the population and getting them off to get their flu shots because we're running out of supplies. I don't believe any of that's true. I've investigated that. I've investigated the data on prevention of these diseases, especially influenza with the flu shots. I don't think the data is there. There are other professionals that agree with me. Dr. Thomas Jefferson, who heads the Cochrane Collaborative Research Database on influenza, also agrees with me. He has been outspoken about how the pharmaceutical industry and policies are really hyping up the danger of influenza and the effectiveness of these vaccines. But you would never know that by listening to the television or reading the newspaper. And I'm quite concerned about the publicity that vaccinations are getting, because it's not balanced and the science isn't there, because we've never done a vaccinated unvaccinated study, because we haven't done, even vaccine studies that are done properly don't follow people out long enough beyond 4 weeks. Most of them, it's 24 to 48 hours. They're not looking for the right things. They're not using just one vaccine. We have to look at necessity. We have to look at effectiveness. And what effectiveness means is not just, does it stimulate an antibody in our systems? That is almost always how trials are done, however, is just to look at how much antibody is stimulated in our systems after we're injected with the vaccine, and what kind of titer, usually around 1 to 4, is considered immune for various viruses. In order to really know if a vaccine is effective, we would have to intentionally expose the vaccinee to the virus and see if they became ill. We would also have to know whether that person was already immune to that particular virus or not. Because say I'm already immune to chickenpox or to the flu, whatever strain is circulating, and you give me a vaccine and I don't get sick. Well, we don't know if I didn't get sick because I was already immune because I've contacted it naturally in the past and perhaps had a subclinical case, which does happen with measles, with chickenpox, with influenza, or whether the vaccine actually had that much of an effect that prevented me from becoming ill. We don't have studies like that. We just have studies that look at the antibody generation after a particular injection. Now, the other problem is that the influenza virus is an RNA virus, and it's a very unstable virus, which is why we have to every year go and create a new vaccine that has different strains in it, because there's all this strain shifting. There's drifting and shifting, which are two different things. But just to say that it's an unstable genetic makeup that changes. And so if you don't have an exact match in your immunity, in your immune system from that vaccine, then that you can't say that that vaccine actually helped you. So say we vaccinated the entire population. Well, how many of them actually were prevented from getting the circulating strains? Well, we don't really know that, but they have taken some look at this. In order to take a look at it, you would have to basically get a viral culture from a person who becomes ill and verify that it is influenza A or influenza B and what strain it is, and then to see if it actually is a strain that matches the vaccine that the person received. And they find that it's actually a fairly low percentage of matches that happen when those